Recorded Books and One-Click Digital present Flintlock by William W. Johnstone with J.A. Johnstone. Narrated by Tom Stechschulte and directed by Kathleen Gormley.
Chapter 1. I'm going to hang you tomorrow at sunup, Sam Flintlock, and I can't guarantee to break your damn neck on account of how I never hung anybody afore, the sheriff said. I'll try, later that, but you see how it is with me. The hammering stopped about an hour ago, so I figured my time was near, Flintlock said. A real nice gallows, you'll like it, Sheriff Dave Cobb said. And I'll make sure it's hung with red, white, and blue bunting so you can go out in style. You'll draw a crowd, Sam, if and that makes you feel better. This pissant town railroaded me into a noose, Cobb. You know it and I know it, Flintlock said. Damn it, boy, you done killed Smiling Dan Sedley, and just about everybody in this valley was kissing kin of his. Old Dan was a well-liked man. He was wanted by the law for bank robbery and murder, Flintlock said. Not in this town he wasn't, Cobb said. The sheriff was a middle-aged man and inclined to be jolly by times. He was big in the belly, and a black spade-shaped beard spread over the lapels of a broadcloth suit coat that looked to be half as old as he was. No hard feelings, huh, Sam? He said. I mean about the hanging and all. Like I told you, I'll do my best. I've been reading a book about how to set the noose and sich, and I reckon I'll get it right.
I got no beef against you, Cobb, Flintlock said. You're the town lawman, and you've got a job to do.
How old are you, young feller?
The lawman said. 40, I guess.
Still too young to die, Cobb sighed. Ah, well. Tell you what, I'll bring you something nice for your last meal tonight. How about steak and eggs? You like steak and eggs?
I don't much care, Sheriff. But there's one thing you can do for me.
Just ask for it. I'm a giving generous man. Dave Cobb by name, Dave Cobb by nature, I always say.
Let me have my grandpappy's old hawking rifle, Flintlock said. It'll be a comfort to me.
Doubt showed in Cobb's face. Now, I don't know about that. That's again all the rules.
Hell, Cobb, the hawking hasn't been shot in 30-40 years, Flintlock said. I ain't much likely to use it to bust out of jail.
You're a strange one, Sam Flintlock, the lawman said. Why'd you carry that old gun around anyhow?
Call me sentimental, Cobb. It was left to me as a legacy, like.
See, my problem is, Sam, you could use that old long gun as a club. Bash my brains out when I wasn't looking.
Not that rifle, I won't. Your head is too thick, Sheriff. I might damage the stock.
Cobb thought for a while, his shaggy black eyebrows beetling. Finally, he smiled and said, All right, I'll bring it to you. But I see you making any fancy moves with that old hawking. I'll shoot your legs off so you can still live long enough to be hung. You catch my drift?
You have my word, Sheriff. I won't give you any trouble.
Cobb nodded. Well, you're a personable enough feller, even though you ain't so well set up and all, so I'll take you at your word.
I appreciate it, Flintlock said. See, I'm named for that hawking.
Your real name Hawking, like?
No. My grandpappy named me for a flintlock rifle, seeing as how I never knew my pa's name.
Hell, why didn't he give you his own name, that Grandpa Leorn?
He said every man should have his father's name. He told me he'd call me Flintlock after the Hawking until I found my ma and she told me who my pa was and what he was called.
You ever find her?
No, I never did. But I'm still on the hunt for, or at least I was.
Your grandpa was a mountain man.
Yeah. He was with Bridger and Hugh Glass and them, at least for a spell. Then he helped survey the Platte and the Sweetwater with Kit Carson and Fremont.
Strange, restless breed they were, mountain men.
You could say that.
I'll bring you the hawking, but mind what I told you about shooting off a part of yourself.
I ain't likely to forget, Flintlock said.
Chapter 2.
Psst! Sam Flintlock sat up on his cot, his mind cobwebbed by sleep.
Psst!
What was that? Rats in the corners again?
Hell, look up here, stupid!
Flintlock rose to his feet. There was a small, barred window high on the wall of his cell where a bearded face looked down at him.
I see you're prospering, Sammy, the man said, grinning. Setting all nice and cozy in the town hooscow.
Flintlock scowled. Come to watch me hang, Abe?
Nah, I was just passing through when I saw the gallows,
Abe Roper said.
I asked who was getting hung, and they said a feller with a big bird tattooed on his throat that goes by the name of Sam Flintlock. I knew it had to be you. There ain't another Ranny in the West with a big bird and that handle.
Here to gloat, Abe, Flintlock said. Getting even for old times?
Hell no, I got nothing against you, Sam. You got me 2 years in Yuma, but you treated me fair and square. And you gave my old lady money the whole time I was inside. Now, why did you do a dumb thing like that?
You had growing young'uns. Them kids had to be fed and clothed.
Yeah, but why the hell did you do it?
I just told you.
I got no liking for bounty hunters, Sammy. But you was a true blue white man taking care of my family like that.
Roper was silent for a moment, then said,
Sally and the kids passed about 3 years ago from the cholera.
I'm sorry to hear that, Flintlock said. I can close my eyes and still see their faces.
It was a hurtful thing, Sam. And me being away on the scout at the time.
You gonna stick around for the hanging, Abe? Flintlock said.
Hell no, and neither are you.
What do you mean?
I mean, there's a barrel of gunpowder against this wall, and it's due to go up in...
Roper looked down briefly.
Oh, I'd say less than half a minute.
The man waved a quick hand.
Hell, I got the light of shuck.
Flintlock stood rooted to the spot for a moment. Then he yelled a startled curse at Roper, grabbed the rifle off his cot, and pulled the mattress on top of him. A couple of seconds later, the Mason City jail blew up with such force, its shingle roof soared into the air and landed intact 20 yards away on top of the brand new gallows. The jail roof and the gallows collapsed in a cloud of dust and killed Sheriff Cobbs's pregnant sow that had been wallowing in the mud under the platform. A shattering shower of adobe and splintered wood rained down on Flintlock, and acrid dust filled his lungs. He threw the mattress aside and staggered to his feet just as Abe Roper kicked aside debris and stepped through the hole in the jailhouse wall.
Sam, get the hell out of there, Roper said. I got your hoss outside.
Flintlock grabbed the Hawken, none the worse for wear, and stumbled outside. As Roper swung into the saddle, Chinese Charlie Fong, grinning as always, tossed Flintlock the reins of a paint.
Good to see you again, Sammy, Fong said.
Feelings mutual, Charlie, Flintlock said. He mounted quickly and ate Roper's dust as he followed the outlaw out of town at a canter. Roper turned in the saddle.
Cracker Jack Bang, Sammy, huh? Have you ever seen the like?
Son of a gun, you could have killed me, Flintlock said.
So what? Who the hell would miss you?
Roper said. Somebody's going to miss this paint pony I'm riding, Flintlock said.
Hell yeah. It's the sheriff's hoss,
Roper grinned.
Better than the $10 Mustang you rode in on, Sam.
Damn you, Abe. Cobb's gonna hang me, then hang me all over again for hoss theft, Flintlock said.
Well, he'll have to catch you first, Roper said, kicking his mount into a gallop.
After an hour of riding through the southern foothills of the Chuska Mountains, the massive rampart of red sandstone buttes and peaks that runs north all the way to the Utah border, Roper drew rein and he and Flintlock waited until Charlie Fong caught up.
Where are we headed, Abe? Flintlock said. I hope you've got a good hideout all picked out.
He and Roper were holed up in a stand of mixed juniper and pinyon.
A nearby high meadow was thick with yellow bells and wild strawberry, and the waning afternoon air smelled sweet of pine and wildflowers.
"We're headed for Fort Defiance, up in the old Navajo country. It's been abandoned for years, but the army's moved back, temporary-like, until old Geronimo is either penned up or dead."
Flintlock scratched at a bug bite under his buckskin shirt and said,
"Is that wise? Me riding into an army fort when I'm on the scout?
There ain't no fighting soldiers there, Sammy. Just cooks and quartermasters and the like," Roper said. "All the cavalry's out looking for Geronimo and them."
"We gonna stay in an army barracks?" Flintlock said. "Say it ain't so."
"Nah. Me and Charlie got us a cabin near the officers' quarters, a cozy enough berth if you're not a complaining man."
Roper peered hard at Flintlock's rugged, unshaven face and then his throat.
"Damn it, Sam. I never did get used to looking at that big bird, even when we rode together."
"I was raised rough," Flintlock said. "You know that."
"Old Barnabas do that to you?" Roper said, passing the makings.
"He wanted it done, but when I was 12, he got an Assiniboine woman to do the tattooing. As I recollect, it hurt considerable."
"What the hell is it, some kind of eagle?"
Flintlock built a cigarette and Roper gave him a match.
"It's a thunderbird."
He thumbed the match into flame and lit a cigarette.
"Barnabas wanted a black and red thunderbird on account of how the Indians reckon it's a sacred bird."
"He wanted it that big? Hell, it pretty much covers your neck and down into your chest."
"Barnabas said folks would remember me because of the bird. He told me that a man folks don't remember is of no account."
"He was a hard old man, was Barnabas. Him and them other mountain men he hung with. A tough, mean bunch as ever was."
"They taught me," Flintlock said. "Each one of them taught me something."
"Like what, for instance?"
"They taught me about whores and whiskey and how to tell the good ones from the bad. They taught me how to stalk a man and how to kill him. And they taught me to never answer a bunch of damned fool questions."
Roper laughed.
"Sounds like old Barnabas and his pals, all right."
"One more thing, Abe. You saved my life today, and they taught me to never forget a thing like that."
Roper, smiling, watched a hawk in flight against the dark blue sky, then again directed his attention to Flintlock.
"You ever heard of the golden bell of Santa Elena, Sam?" he said.
"Can't say as I have."
"You will. And after I tell you about it, I'll ask you to repay the favor you owe me."
Chapter 3. "Are you sure you saw deer out here, Captain Shaw? It might have been a shadow among the trees."
"Look at the tracks in the wash, Major. Deer have passed this way and not long ago."
"I see tracks all right," Major Philip Ashton said. He looked around him. "But I'm damned if I see any deer."
"Sir, may I suggest we move farther up the wash, as far as the foothills," Captain Owen Shaw said. "Going on dusk, the deer will move out of the timber."
Ashton, a small, compact man with a florid face, an affable disposition, and a taste for bonded whiskey, nodded.
"As good a suggestion as any, Captain. We'll wait until dark, and if we don't see a deer, we'll leave it for another day."
"As you say, sir," Shaw said.
He watched the Major walk ahead of him. Like himself, Ashton wore civilian clothes, but he carried a regulation model 1873 trapdoor Springfield rifle. Shaw was armed with a .44-40 Winchester because he wanted nothing to go wrong on this venture. No awkward questions to be answered later. Major Ashton, who had never held a combat command, carried his rifle at the slant, as though advancing on an entrenched enemy and not a herd of non-existent mule deer. Shaw was 30 years old that spring. He'd served in a frontier cavalry regiment, but he'd been banished to Fort Defiance as a commissary officer after a passionate, though reckless, affair with the young wife of a farrier sergeant. Shaw wasn't at all troubled by his exile.
It was safer to dole out biscuit and salt beef than do battle with Sioux and Cheyenne warriors. Of course, the Apaches were a problem, but since the Navajo attacked the fort in 1858 and 1860, and both times were badly mauled, it seemed that the wily Geronimo was giving the place a wide berth. That last suited Captain Shaw perfectly. He had big plans, and they sure as hell didn't involve Apaches. The wash, dry now that the spring melt was over, made a sharp cut to the north, and the two officers followed it through a grove of stunted juniper and willow onto a rocky plateau bordered by thick stands of pine. In the distance, the fading day painted the Chuska peaks with wedges of deep lilac shadow, and out among the foothills, coyotes yipped. The jade sky was streaked with banners of scarlet and gold, the streaming colors of the advancing night. Major Ashton walked onto the plateau, his attention directed at the pines, his rifle at the ready. He stopped and scanned the trees with his field glasses. Without turning his head, he said,
"Nothing moving yet, Captain."
Shaw made no answer.
"You have a buck spotted?"
the major whispered. Again he got no reply. Ashton turned. Shaw's rifle was pointed right at his chest.
"What in blazes are you doing, Captain Shaw?"
Ashton said, his face alarmed.
"Killing you, Major."
Owen Shaw fired. The soft-nosed .44-40 round tore into the major's chest and plowed through his lungs. Even as the echoing report of the Winchester racketed around the plateau, Ashton fell to his hands and knees and coughed up a bouquet of glistening red blossoms. Shaw smiled and shot Ashton again, this time in the head. The major fell on his side and all the life that remained in him fled. Moving quickly, Shaw stood over Ashton and fired half a dozen shots into the air, the spent cartridge cases falling on and around the major's body. He then pulled a Smith & Wesson 32 from the pocket of his tweed hunting jacket, placed the muzzle against his left thigh, and pulled the trigger. A red-hot poker of pain burned across Shaw's leg, and when he looked down at the wound, he was pleased. It was only a flesh wound, but it was bleeding nicely, enough to make him look a hero when he rode into Fort Defiance. Limping slightly, Shaw retraced his steps along the dry wash to the place where he and Ashton had tethered their horses. He looked behind him and, to his joy, saw that he'd left a blood trail. Good. There was always the possibility that a cavalry patrol had returned to the fort and their Pima scouts could be bad news. The blood would help his cover-up. He gathered up the reins of the major's horse and swung into the saddle. There was no real need to hurry, but he forced his horse into a canter, Ashton's mount dragging on him. It was an officer's duty to recover the body of a slain comrade, but Ashton had been of little account and not well liked. When Shaw told of the Apache ambush and his desperate battle to save the wounded major, that little detail would be overlooked, and his own bloody wound spoke loud of gallantry and devotion to duty. Lamps were already lit when Captain Owen Shaw rode into Fort Defiance, a sprawling complex of buildings, some of them ruins, grouped around a dusty parade ground. He staged his entrance well. Not for him to enter at a gallop and hysterically warn of Apaches. Rather, he slumped in the saddle and kept his horse to a walk. The wounded warrior's noble return. He was glad that just as he rode past the sutler's store, big, laughing Sergeant Patrick Tone stepped outside, a bottle of whiskey tucked under his arm. "Sergeant," Shaw said, making sure he sounded exhausted and sore hurt. "Sound officer's call. Direct the gentleman to the commandant's office."
"Where is Major Ashton, sir?"
Tone said, his Irish brogue heavy on his tongue. Like many soldiers in the Indian Fighting Army, he'd been born and bred in the Emerald Isle and was far from the rainy green hills of his native land.
"He's dead. Apaches. Now carry out my order."
Tone shifted the bottle from his right to his left underarm and snapped off a salute. Then he stepped quickly toward the enlisted men's barracks, roaring for the bugler. Shaw dismounted outside the administration building, a single-story adobe structure. Its timber porch hung with several large clay ollas that held drinking water. The ollas' constant evaporation supposedly helped keep the interior offices cool, a claim the soldiers vehemently denied. After leaning against his horse for a few moments, the action of an exhausted man, Shaw limped up the three steps to the porch, drops of blood from his leg starring the rough pine. He stopped, swaying slightly, when he saw a woman bustling toward him across the parade ground, her swirling skirts lifting veils of yellow dust. Shaw smiled inwardly. This was getting better and better. Here comes the distraught widow. Maud Ashton, the major's wife, was a plump, motherly woman with a sweet, heart-shaped face that normally wore a smile. But now she looked concerned, as though she feared to hear news she already knew would be bad. Maud mounted the steps, and one look at the expression on Shaw's face and the blood on his leg told her all she needed to know. She asked the question anyway.
Captain Shaw, where is my husband?
As the stirring notes of officer's call rang around him, Shaw made an act of battling back a sob.
Oh, Maud.
He couldn't go on. The captain opened his arms wide, tears staining his cheeks, and Maud Ashton ran between them. Shaw clasped her tightly and whispered,
Philip is dead.
Maud had been a soldier's wife long enough to know that the day might come when she'd have to face those three words. Now she repeated them.
Philip is dead.
Apaches, Shaw said. He steadied himself and managed. They jumped us out by rock wash, and Major Ashton fell in the first volley. Maud took a step back. Her pretty face, unstained by tears, was stony.
And Philip is still out there?
Boots thudded onto the porch, and Shaw decided to wait until his two officers were present before he answered Maud's irritating question. First Lieutenant Frank Headley was in his early 50s, missing the left arm he'd lost at Gettysburg as a brevet brigadier general of artillery. He was a private, withdrawn man, too fond of the bottle to be deemed fit for further promotion. He'd spent the past 15 years in the same regular army rank. This had made him bitter, and his drinking and irascible manner worsened day by day. Standing next to him was Second Lieutenant Miles Howard, an earnest 19-year-old fresh out of West Point. His application for a transfer to the hard-riding 5th Cavalry had recently been approved on the recommendation of the Point Superintendent, the gallant Colonel Wesley Merritt, the regiment's former commander. Howard had a romantic view of the frontier war, his imagination aflame with flying banners, bugle calls, and thundering charges with the saber. He'd never fought Apaches.
Where's the major? Headley said.
He's dead, Shaw said. We got hit by Apaches at Rock Wash, and Major Ashton fell. Headley turned and saw the dead officer's horse.
Where is he?
Shaw shook his head and then stared directly and sincerely at Maud.
I had to leave him. The Apaches wanted his body, but I stood over him and drove them away. But I was sore wounded and couldn't muster the strength to lift the gallant major onto his horse.
Lieutenant Howard, more perceptive and more sympathetic than Headley, watched blood drops from Shaw's leg tick onto the timber.
Sir, you need the post surgeon, he said.
Later, Lieutenant. Right now, I want you and Mr. Headley in the commandant's office, Shaw said, grimacing. A badly wounded soldier, determined to be brave.
Chapter 4.
Something going on with the soldiers, Charlie Fong said. He stood at the open door of the cabin smoking a black cheroot.
They got cooks and clerks lined up with rifles and the headquarters buildings all lit up.
Sam Flintlock stepped to the door and looked over Fong's shoulder. A dented moon hung high in the night sky and spilled weak white light across the parade ground. The air was cool and smelled of dust kicked up by the dozen troops who stood at shabby attention outside the commandant's office, spiced by the faint horse odor of the empty cavalry stables. Flintlock turned his head and looked at Abe Roper, who sat at smiling ease on a wooden rocker by the iron stove, a glass of whiskey in his hand.
"They ain't coming for you, Abe, are they? Or me?" Flintlock said.
"Hell no, we ain't done nothing in this neck of the woods," Roper said. "Well, me and Charlie drove a few rustled head down into Mexico a couple of weeks back, but that shouldn't bother the army none."
"The doctor's wearing his white coat, and he just went into the major's office at a trot," Fong said.
"Maybe the major's feeling poorly," Roper said. "Don't he get the croup now and then?"
"Hell, they wouldn't turn out the troops for the croup," Flintlock said.
"If you're so all-fired interested, why don't you wander over there and see what's going on, Sammy?" Roper said. "Could be Indian trouble."
"God help us if old Geronimo attacks the fort," Flintlock said. "You should see what's passing for soldiers out there."
"It's funny," Charlie Fong said, grinning. "Hank Long, the mess cook's out there, and he can't button his soldier tunic over his big fat belly. Looks like that young Lieutenant Howard is yelling at him."
"He's a good cook, though, Hank is," Roper said, "when he puts his mind to it and stays sober."
"I hope he's a better cook than he is a soldier," Flintlock said. Then after a moment, "Hell, I'm going over there."
"Wait, Sammy," Roper said. "You better take a real gun with you. If Geronimo attacks, your old hawking won't do you any good. Hey, Charlie, give him Vince Lawson's guns."
As Fong stepped inside the cabin again, Flintlock said, "Won't old Vince need his guns?"
"Not in hell he don't," Roper said.
He read the question on Flintlock's face and added,
"Vince got hung by a hemp posse."
"Friend of your name?" Flintlock said.
"Business associate."
"Ah, then that explains it," Flintlock said.
Fong opened a brass-bound trunk, unwrapped an oily green cloth, and produced a blue Colt with a yellowed bone handle. The barrel had been cut back to the length of the ejector rod, and there was no front sight.
"It's handy," Roper said. "You'll find cartridges on the shelf over there by the door."
Fong handed the Colt to Flintlock and laid a Winchester on the rough pine table.
"Both 44 caliber, Sam. There's no leather for the revolver on account of how old Vince was a waistband-carrying man."
"Well, if it was good enough for old Vince that got hung, then it's good enough for me."
Flintlock examined the Colt and the rifle, then said,
"I reckon I owe you $25, Abe."
"Sammy, you're gonna help make me rich, so forget about it," Roper said. "Call them guns a gift out of the goodness of my heart."
"You getting rich? You talking about the golden bell of Saint what's-her-name?" Flintlock said.
"Yeah, but we'll discuss it later if the Apaches don't scalp us afore then."
Flintlock shoved the Colt in his waistband, then pulled his buckskin shirt over the handle.
"And I'll mosey over to the soldiers and find out what's happening," he said.
"I'd load that revolver first if I was you, Sammy," Roper said.
"Damn, I plumb forgot," Flintlock said.
"You've been carrying that damned hawking too long, you ask me," Roper said.
Sam Flintlock walked into the moon-splashed night past the tall wild oak that grew, despite all the odds, at the edge of the parade ground. He was 38 that spring, not 40 as he claimed, short, stocky, and as rough as a cob. A shock of unruly black hair showed under his battered straw hat, and his eyes, gray as a sea mist, were deep set under shaggy eyebrows. His mustache was full in the dragoon style, and he walked with a horseman's stiff-kneed gait. If he'd chosen to, he could have sold his clothes, including his boots, for 10 cents. Flintlock was tough, enduring, raised to be hard by hard men. But there was no cruelty in him, much honesty of tongue, and he had a quick, wry sense of humor. He liked horrors, children, and dogs, and was kind to all of them. He'd killed 8 men, 3 as a lawman, the remainder since he turned bounty hunter. None of those dead men disturbed his sleep of nights, and the only ghost he ever saw was that of wicked old Barnabas. But Lieutenant Miles Howard was aware of none of these things. As Flintlock walked toward him that night, he made the snap judgment that here was a typical frontier tough, all horns and rattles, a far cry from any kind of gentleman. The man's throat was grotesque, tattooed with a bird of some kind. He was not the sort the lieutenant would care to meet at any kind of social gathering. Flintlock's opening words did nothing to dispel that opinion.
"What the hell's happening?"
Howard looked Flintlock up and down before he answered, taking in the man's stained woolen pants, down-at-heel boots, battered shapeless hat, and buckskin shirt, shiny black at the armpits and chest from ancient sweat. He didn't like what he saw.
"And you are?" he said.
"Sam old Flintlock. Me and my 2 compadres just rode in, and your name, sonny?"
Howard was outraged, and he noisily slammed his saber closer to his side. "Second Lieutenant Miles Howard at your service." Then after a pause, "What can I do for you?"
"We saw all you soldier boys lined up and wondered what the hell happened," Flintlock said. "You borrowed yourself some Indian trouble?"
The soldier's disdain for inquisitive civilians showed on the lieutenant's face.
"Hostile Apaches attacked a hunting party from this post," he said. "Major Ashton was killed in the engagement, and Captain Shaw was wounded. We fear an imminent attack by the hostiles."
Howard's next words sounded more like a question than a statement of fact.
"Though Apaches don't fight at night."
"They do when it suits them, Lieutenant," Flintlock said.
He waved toward the motley collection of soldiers, still standing at shambling attention.
"Is that all you've got?"
"Yes. Should the hostiles attack, my flying column will be more than enough to mount a stout and spirited defense."
Flintlock shook his head.
"Then God help us," he said.
Chapter 5. The defenders of Fort Defiance stood to all night. There was no Apache attack. However, just before dawn, the flimsy timber door of Roper's cabin was attacked with considerable force by a gloved fist.
"Go away," Abe Roper yelled, "or I'll shoot you right where you stand."
"Open up. This is Lieutenant Howard."
"Who?" Roper said.
Flintlock sat up in his blankets and yawned.
"He's the 10-year-old kid I told you about, the one the Army calls an officer."
Roper put on his hat, got to his feet, and padded across the floor in his long-handled underwear. He opened the door just as Howard raised his fist to strike again. The young officer saluted smartly and said,
"Good morning, sir. I have a favor to ask."
Roper's voice was hoarse from smoke and whiskey.
"You wake up a man in the middle of the night and then ask him to do you a favor?"
Taken aback, Howard said, "But, sir, it's 5 o'clock. Didn't you hear reveille?"
"Boy, that's for soldiers, not civilians," Roper said. "Now get to—"
"What can we do for you, Lieutenant?"
Flintlock said, stepping to the door. Like Roper, he wore only his long johns and hat.
"Ah, yes. Good morning, Mr.
Flintlock."
"Yes, yes, indeed, Mr. Flintlock. It's nice to make your acquaintance again.
Tell us what you want, soldier boy, or my friend here's liable to shoot you out of spite," Flintlock said.
Howard had changed from his KP to a wide-brimmed campaign hat and faded blue shirt adorned with his shoulder straps. He ditched his saber and carried only a revolver in a flapped holster.
"I need your help," Howard said.
"What kind of help?"
Roper said, his voice edged with suspicion.
I'm detailed to recover Major Ashton's body, and I've procured a wagon for that purpose, Howard said.
So?
Roper said. It's a small wagon, Howard said.
I'm not catching your drift, son, Roper said.
He turned his head to Flintlock.
Do you catch his drift?
I think so. You can't carry soldiers in the wagon, and even if you could, you know you can't turn a bunch of company clerks into Apache fighting infantry, Flintlock said.
He smiled.
Is that about the size of it, Lieutenant?
For a few moments, Howard was lost for words, but he finally managed. Sergeant Tone saw you gentlemen ride in last night, and he said you appeared to be well-mounted and armed with repeating rifles. If we engage the Apaches, I'd appreciate your fire support.
Not a chance, soldier boy, Roper said, making to close the door. We make it a rule never to fight Apaches or any other kind of Indian. Live longer that way, and have hair to comb.
Howard stuck his foot in the doorway. I'm authorized by Captain Shaw to pay you $5 each to take part in the expedition, 10 if we encounter hostiles.
Roper shook his head.
No deal, boy. Now you run along like a good little soldier and tell Captain Shaw where he can stick his $5.
Very well, Howard said, then louder.
Sergeant Tone, burn down this cabin. It's been condemned as unfit for human occupation by the authority of Captain Shaw. Hey, you can't do that, Roper sputtered. This is my cabin.
The dwelling is on Army property, so you're trespassing, Howard said. Sergeant Tone, carry out my order. A torch flared in the morning half-light, and the big non-com marched toward the cabin, the flaming brand in one hand, a can of coal oil in the other. The soldiers, looking more unkempt and sloppy after standing to all night, had their rifles trained on the door, and they seemed mean enough and angry enough to cut loose if they had to.
Wait! Roper yelled. All right! We'll join the... whatever the hell you called it. Pat Tone, you damned Mick, get away from here with that torch before you burn us all to death.
Saw the light, huh, Abe?
Tone grinned. It's about time, and damn ye for a benighted heathen.
Damn Micks. Damned army. Damned officer. Damned Apaches, Roper said. Then let's get it done.
He made a stand, a small act of defiance.
But I ain't going nowhere without my coffee,
Howard said. And you, Mr. Flintlock? Yes, of course. Will you join us?
It ain't my cabin.
Sam, if you don't ride with us to wipe the noses of the soldier boys, I'll take it hard, Roper said. Besides that, I'll shoot you the first chance I get.
You got a way with words, don't you, Abe? Flintlock said.
Well?
What's in it for me?
The golden bell.
Ring-a-ding-ding, Flintlock said.
What the hell does that mean?
It means I'll ride with you, Abe. But if the bell turns out to be a big windy, it's me who will shoot you the first chance I get.
I suggest you gentlemen save your ammunition for the Apaches, Howard said. He looked at Roper. There's coffee in the mess hall, and be quick about it. Thank God the hostiles didn't get a chance to mutilate Major Ashton's body, Lieutenant Howard said. Captain Shaw was right. The Major was indeed a gallant officer.
Ain't he, though, Flintlock said. Hell, the Major looks as good as new lying there.
Howard chose to ignore that and said, The spent cartridges tell the story. See how Captain Shaw stood over the Major's body and drove off the hostiles with steady and courageous rifle fire.
He deserves a medal, Flintlock said.
And I'm sure he'll be awarded one of the highest order, Howard said, a single tear rolling down his plump young cheek. He's a hero, like the gallant Custer.
Hey, how come I scouted this whole meadow and didn't see any blood? Flintlock said.
Yeah, strange that, Charlie Fong said, chewing on a stem of grass. What do you mean?
Howard said.
Well, if the captain done all this here shooting and drove away Apaches, who don't quit easy, you'd at least think he winged a couple.
No blood on the grass, Fong said,
and again,
strange that.
The air was hot and close and smelled of distant rain.
The reason is obvious to a thinking man, Howard said, slightly angry. Obviously, Captain Shaw put up such a stout defense that, despite suffering no casualties, the cowardly hostiles fled in confusion.
Soldier boy, the Apaches are many things, most of them bad, but being cowards ain't one of them,
Abe Roper said.
Then I beg to differ, Howard said. Fort Defiance drove off with ease attacks by hostiles twice in half a dozen years. Note I say with ease, Mr. Roper.
Lieutenant, those were Navajo, Roper said. When it comes to sand and meanness, 100 of them don't stack up to a single Apache.
I'm here to return Major Ashton's body to the fort, not to argue the point about savages, Howard said. He turned to the two sullen privates who'd come with the wagon. You men, load the Major's body. He's an officer and a gentleman, remember. Treat him with all due respect for his rank.
As the two soldiers struggled to load the Major's body into the wagon, Roper took Flintlock aside.
What do you reckon, Sammy? He said.
The captain never fit Apaches here, I reckon that much. No bloodstains in the grass out there, no horse tracks, no spent shells.
Why the hell would he lie about it?
Well, he and the Major were deer hunting. Shaw might have plugged the man by accident and then skedaddled.
Yeah, after he fired a few rounds over Ashton's body to back up his Apache story and then shot himself in the leg.
Then added,
makes sense, Roper said. What do you think, Charlie?
Good an explanation as any, Fong said. Sam's right. There's no sign that Apaches were ever here.
He could have done it on purpose, Roper said.
You mean Shaw murdered him? Flintlock said.
Maybe so.
Why? Roper shrugged.
Who knows?
A woman, maybe, Flintlock said.
You've seen Ashton's wife. Shaw didn't murder his commanding officer over her.
Then it was an accident.
I don't know what it was, Roper said. Do we care?
No, I guess not, Flintlock said. But I got the feeling there's something mighty strange going on around here.
Roper grinned.
I declare, Sammy, you're like an old maiden aunt who hears a rustle in every bush.
Maybe I am, Flintlock said. Or maybe I'm not.
Chapter 6.
So, how do you like the old crow sipping whiskey, Sammo?
Abe Roper said.
Besides Robert E. Lee, it's the best thing that ever came out of the South, Flintlock said.
He set his glass on the floor beside his rickety chair, one of only two in the cabin.
Abe, tell me about the bell, he said.
Getting gold fever, Sam?
Charlie Fong grinned.
Getting curious, Charlie, Flintlock said.
That's what killed the cat, Sammy, Roper said.
So let the cat out of the bag and we'll see what happens, Flintlock said.
All right. First the story, then I'll tell you where it happened. That set fine by you?
Story away.
Once upon a time, I like it already, Flintlock said. There was a Spanish mission at a place north of here, Roper said. For 200 years, the holy monks took care of the local Indians, converted them to the one true faith, and did many good works.
Flintlock ran an oily cloth over the barrel of the Hawken.
You should have been a preacher, Abe, he said. When you try, you're a fine-talking man.
Thought about it for a spell, but then I figured I was more suited to the bank-robbing profession.
You were cut out for that, all right, Abe, Charlie Fong said.
Thanks, Charlie. I appreciate it,
Roper said, bowing his head in acknowledgment of the compliment.
So, the holy monks are going about baptizing folks and doing good works, then what? Flintlock said.
His entire attention seemed to be focused on scraping a speck of rust off the Hawkins barrel with his thumbnail.
Well, suddenly the monks was in a heap of trouble, Roper said. Bad stuff coming down if you catch my drift.
You don't say?
I do say. See how it come up over the years? The Indians brought the monks all kinds of gold as presents, like. I mean, they knew how all white men love gold, and the monks were no exception.
Just like us, Abe, Charlie Fong said.
Truer words was never spoken, Charlie, Flintlock said. I hate to break it to you, but you're not just like us. You ain't a white man, Charlie.
No, I'm a yellow man.
Close, but no cigar, Flintlock said.
Now, where was I? Oh, yeah. The gold the Indians was bringing was raw. Nuggets and dust, most likely. Not golden rings and chalices and the like, Roper said. The monks ended up with quite a poke, but then they got nervous.
How come? Flintlock said.
I never seen a nervous monk. Well, them old monks was nervous right enough. It seems that the King of Spain's tax collector got wind of the stash, and it was in his mind to... What's that word, Charlie?
Confiscate.
Ah, yeah. Confiscate the gold and send it back to Spain for the king to spend on women and whiskey.
Flintlock laid the now gleaming hawken across his knees.
Harsh thing, that. Robbing holy monks who did nothing but good works, he said. It was all of that. But then the monks put their heads together and came up with a plan. This is where the story gets good, Fong said, grinning. So let me tell it, Charlie, huh? Roper said.
Go right ahead, Abe. Sorry, but I always get excited at this part.
Roper glared at Fong for a few moments, then said,
Well, anywho, the monks did two things. They made a cast for a bell.
What kind of bell? Flintlock said.
A big bell. How would I know what kind of bell?
Well, there's a hand bell and a...
A big bell, like I said. Sammy, it was a big bell, all right?
Flintlock nodded.
Fine. A church bell. Go right ahead, Abe.
I swear you're a worse interrupter than Charlie, Roper said.
So the monks melted down the gold and cast it into a bell, Flintlock said.
Yeah, that's what they did, all right. Made a big bell.
Wouldn't the tax collector notice a big golden bell? Flintlock said. I mean, it would be pretty obvious.
The monks thought of that. They painted the bell black, rubbed rust onto the surface, and then hung it above the entrance to the mission. The tax collector rode under the bell and never knew it was made of solid gold.
Flintlock built a cigarette and, without looking up, said,
How heavy was the big bell?
I knew you'd get around to asking that, Sammel. Are you ready for this?
I guess I am, but I'm holding my breath.
It weighs 2,000 pounds of pure, shining gold.
How much is that in American money? Flintlock said.
Tell him, Charlie, Roper said. I want to see his face.
$65,000 and a few cents, more or less, Fong said. Big bell, big money, Sam.
How did they get it up there? Flintlock said.
Roper was puzzled.
Get what up there?
The big bell. If it weighs as much as you say it does, how did they hang it above the mission gate?
Pulleys and willing hands, Roper said. How the hell should I know, Sammy? You sure ask some dumb questions.
All right, then here's another dumb question. Where do I come in?
That ain't dumb. It's a true blue question as ever was,
Roper said. Then answer it, Flintlock said.
We need your gun, Sammel. That's how come I saved you from getting hung. I mean, once I knowed it was really you.
I smell a rat. Flintlock said, Damn it, I'm sure I smell a rat.
And no wonder, by anybody's reckoning, it's a real big rat, Charlie Fong said.
How big?
Flintlock said. For the first time that night, he felt uneasy.
How about Ace a Pag big?
Roper said. Those words hit Flintlock like five hard jabs to the belly.
"You've got to be joking," he said. "You want me to say ha-ha, right?"
"No joke," Roper said. "He's in this neck of the woods. How we know, we heard he'd killed a man at a settlement down in the Zuni Buttes country of the New Mexico Territory."
"Asa always operates south of the Mogollon Rim," Flintlock said. "It's his home range, and he never budges."
"He budged," Roper said.
"He still run with Logan Dean and Joe Hart and them?" Flintlock said.
"I don't know."
"Why is he here, Abe?" Flintlock said. He figured he already knew the answer to that question, and Roper confirmed it.
"We think, me and Charlie, that maybe he heard about the Golden Bell."
"How?" Roper looked at Charlie Fong.
"Sam, the way it was told to us, a prospector was up in the Red Rock Valley when he got caught in a snowstorm," Fong said. "Well, he headed west into the Carrizo Mountains and took refuge in a cave."
"And he saw the bell," Flintlock said.
"Yeah, a huge bell made of solid gold. He says the sight of it made him sick and he didn't stay long."
"Was he sober?" Flintlock said.
"Sober enough to know he couldn't move 2,000 pounds of gold by himself," Roper said.
"So he came to you," Flintlock said.
"Nope. We happened on him by chance in a saloon down Silver City way," Roper said. "That was 2 months ago.
"And he told you the story about the monks and the gold and you believed him?"
"Not right off, we didn't. Ain't that right, Charlie?"
"Damn right. Until the old-timer showed us a map he'd made of the mountains and an X marking the cave," Fong said. "Then we figured he was telling the truth."
"Tin pans tell big stories. Everybody knows that," Flintlock said. "How much did you pay him for the map?"
"Not one thin dime," Roper said. "He said his time was short on account of how he couldn't breathe, and if we found the bell and sold it, we were to send some of the money to his widowed sister in Richmond. Give us a paper with her address and all. Said the lady's husband wore the gray and fell at Gettysburg. Man doesn't lie about a thing like that."
"Then how did Asa Pagg get wind of the bell?" Flintlock said.
Roper smiled as he admired the amber glow of his whiskey.
"Sammy," he said, "a man can have an affair d'amour with the wife of the President of these United States and keep it a secret. But if a man strikes pay dirt in a wilderness, within a week he finds himself in the middle of a gold rush.
In other words, when gold's involved, word gets around," Fong said.
"So your dying prospector got drunk and blabbed," Flintlock said.
"Maybe so," Roper said.
"Where the hell did you pick up fancy words like affaire d'amour? You going back to school or something?" Flintlock said.
"Nah, an El Paso whore teach that to me," Roper said. "I took a shine to it like..."
"Educated whore," Flintlock said.
"No, she wasn't. She was a French gal from up Canada way, and she was as dumb as dirt."
"All right. Then why me, Abe?"
"Call yourself a gift from heaven, Sammel. I knowed it when I sprung you from that rube jail."
"Blew me up, you mean?"
"Don't be so harsh, Sam," Charlie Fong said. "We figured you had 1 chance in 10 of surviving the gunpowder. Them's better odds than the hangman would have given you of walking away after the drop."
"To anybody but a Chinaman, them's lousy odds," Flintlock said. "But go ahead, Abe. Why me?"
"Because I can't shade Asa Pagg, but you can," Roper said. "Charlie, can I say it any plainer than that? Am I right or am I wrong?"
"No, sir, you're right, and you can't say it plainer," Fong said.
"And study on this, Sammy," Roper said. "If for some reason we don't find the big bell, last time I looked, Asa had a 5,000 reward on his head, dead or alive. Gun old Asa, and in a manner of speaking, you'd be mixing business with pleasure. Ain't that right, Charlie?"
"Truer words was never spoke," Fong said.
"So, what do you say, Sammel?" Roper said.
"Like you said, I'll study on it," Flintlock said.
I admit that the bounty on Asa Pag kind of tilts the scales in your favor.
Just don't sit on your gun hand too long, Roper said. We're riding out as soon as Jack Coffin gets here.
I never liked that breed, Flintlock said. He still collect trigger fingers?
As far as I know, Roper said. You don't have to like them, Sammy. Who the hell does? But if the Tin Pan's map ain't exact, he'll find that cave for us. I may gun him.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.